Hello, Mr. Richard Ebright. We wish to know about your life.
Okay. An only child. I grew up in north of Reading, Pennsylvania. My hometown. But there was nothing much I could do there. I couldn't play football or baseball with a team of one. But there was one thing I could do there.
What?
Collect things. So he did, and did he ever. Ebright began collecting butterflies in his kindergarten. He also collected rocks, fossils, and coins. He became an eager astronomer too, sometimes stargazing all night.
Ebright was born in Reading, Pennsylvania. Being an only child, he collected things, butterflies, fossils, rocks, and coins. He was an eager astronomer too, gazing at the sky all night.
He had a driving curiosity, with a bright mind. My mother encouraged my interest in learning. She took me on trips. She bought me telescopes, microscopes, cameras, and other equipments, and helped me in many other ways.
I was his only companion, until he started school. After that, I would bring home friends for him. But at night, we just did things together. Richard was my whole life. After his father died, when Richie was in third grade, I and Richie spent almost every evening at the dining room table. If he didn't have things to do, I would find work for him. Not physical work, but learning things. Because of this, he earned top grades in school. But on everyday things, he was just like every other kid.
By the time he was in second grade, he had collected all the 25 species of butterflies found around his town. That would have been the end of my butterfly collecting. But then, my mother got me a children's book called The Travels of Monarch 10. The book told how monarch butterflies migrate to Central America. That book opened the world of science to me. How? At the end of the book, readers were invited to help study butterfly migrations. They were asked to tag butterflies. For research by Dr. Frederick Urquhart of University of Toronto, Canada. After reading the book, I began to tag butterflies. Anyone who found a tagged butterfly was asked to send the tag to Dr. Urquhart.
Ebright's mother bought him a book called The Travels of Monarch 10. At the end, readers were invited to help study butterfly migrations. For research by Dr. Frederick Urquhart of the University of Toronto, Canada. They were asked to tag butterflies. Soon, Ebright started tagging butterflies.
The butterfly collecting season around Reading lasts only 6 weeks in late summer. So if you're going to catch them one by one, you won't catch many. So, Ebright's next step was to raise a flock of butterflies. He would catch a female monarch, take her eggs, raise them in his basement, from egg, to caterpillar, to pupa, to adult butterfly. Then, he would tag their wings, and let them go.
For several years, his basement was home to thousands of monarchs, in different stages of development.
Eventually, I began to lose interest in tagging butterflies. Because, it's tedious, and there is not much feedback.
Tedious means, boring and monotonous.
In all the time I did it, only two butterflies were recaptured, and they weren't much far from my home. When he was in seventh grade, he got a hint of what real science was. When he entered a county science fair, he lost. Because his entry was slides of frog tissues, which he neatly showed under a microscope. It was really a sad feeling for him to sit there and not get anything. While everyone had won something, he realized that the winners had done some real experiments, not just made a neat display. I knew that for the next year's fair, I would have to do some real experiments. The subject I knew most was the insect work I had been doing for several years. So I wrote to Dr. Urquhart for ideas and came back a stack of suggestions for experiments. Those kept me busy all through high school and led to many prize projects in the science fairs.
Can you detail them, please?
Because of a viral disease which kills nearly all monarch caterpillars, he thought the disease was carried by a beetle. So, he tried to raise monarch caterpillars in presence of the beetles. He didn't get any real results. But he showed he had tried. This time, he won. Next year, His science fair project was to check the theory that viceroys copy monarch butterflies. The theory was that monarchs do not taste good to birds, but viceroys taste good to birds. The theory was that viceroys copy monarchs so that they are less likely to become a bird's dinner. Ebright's project was to see whether birds would eat monarchs. He found that a starling would eat all monarchs it could get, and it doesn't eat ordinary bird food. Now he got first place in zoology and third overall in the science fair. In his second year of high school, he tried to answer a question. What's the purpose of the 12 tiny gold spots on monarch pupa? Everyone thought they were just ornamental. But Dr. Urquhart didn't believe it. So, Ebright and an excellent science student built a device that showed the spots were producing hormones necessary for the butterfly's development. That project won the first place. And it also made his entry to International Science and Engineering Fair. There, he won third place in zoology. He got chance to work at entomology lab of Walter Reed Army Institute of Research. In his senior year of high school, he continued his research on those gold spots. He grew cells from monarch's wings in a culture and showed the cells would develop into a butterfly only if they were fed by the hormones produced by the gold spots. The project won first place for zoology at the International Fair. After graduation, he spent a summer at the Army Lab. After his first year in Harvard University, he did more work on the hormone from the gold spots. Using the lab's instruments, he was able to identify the chemical structure of the hormone. During junior year, Ebright was looking at YHE X-ray photos of the chemical structure. He got the idea for his new theory about cell life. He believed that his findings and photos gave answer to the question, how cell can read the blueprints of its DNA? He and his college roommate, James R. Wong, worked all night drawing pictures and constructing plastic models to show how it together. They both later wrote the paper that explained the theory. They explained the theory in an article in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. This was the first time that this journal had ever published the work of college students.
At the age of 22, Richard excited the scientific world with a new theory on how cells work. They both explained the theory in a journal, Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. Never before this journal had published the work of college students.
Ebright graduated from Harvard with highest honors, second in his class. He became a graduate student researcher at Harvard Medical School. There, he began doing experiments to test his theory. If the theory proves correct, it will be a big step towards understanding the processes of life. It might also lead to new ideas for preventing some types of cancer and other diseases. All of this is possible only because of Ebright's scientific curiosity. His research of in high school about the gold spots led him to his new theory about cell life. His curiosity made him to think about those gold spots. He has been interested in science since he first began collecting butterflies, but not so deeply that he hasn't time for other interests. Ebright was a champion debater and public speaker. He was a good canoeist too. He was an all-round person. He was an expert photographer, mainly of nature and scientific exhibits.
Besides an excellent scientist, Ebright was a champion debater, public speaker, canoeist, and an expert photographer.
When Richard was in high school, he was a straight A student because learning was easy. He used his energy towards the debating and model United Nations clubs. He admired Richard O'Hara, his social studies teacher and an advisor to the clubs. Mr. O'Hara was the perfect person for me then. He opened my mind with new ideas.
Richard would always give extra effort. What pleased me was that he put 3 or 4 hours at night doing debate research, besides doing all his research with butterflies and other interests. Richard was competitive, but not in the bad sense. Richard wasn't interested in winning for winning's sake, or winning to get prize. Rather, he was winning because he wanted to do the best job he could. For the right reasons, he wants to be the best.
The making of a scientist includes these ingredients. Start with a first-rate mind, add curiosity, and add mix in the will to win for the right reasons. Ebright has these qualities.
The making of a scientist starts with a first-rate mind, add curiosity, and mix in the will to win for right reasons.
Please subscribe this channel for more videos like this. Like and share this video. You can comment if you've a question. Stay tuned.